impression on you are on tour.
I keep trying to tell the TV cameraman that.
But that's not doing it justice.
Thank you. Kevin.
Hi.
See you.
Hi.
Leslie, how are you?
I'm just fine.
Good to see you.
Mr. President, Vice Commandant of the Coast Guard. Here to help.
Brother. Good to see you, sir. How are you?
If we get the family and Admiral behind the tables over here.
Behind the...
On the desk here.
On the desk. And the press is going to come in.
To the right of the president, sir. Put your right foot to the president.
How you doing?
Good to see you. See you just like that. Yes. You want the chair over there? Okay.
Thank you.
One just put right there.
I'll catch it.
You should all step in. Step in. One of you standing on either side here, much more here.
It's only going to be one way.
I always do what I'm told, sir.
We're here today to honor Arlen Williams, Jr. Many Americans all over this country have been well aware. Oh, I thought you were all in. Repeat this. We're here to honor Arlen Williams, Jr. Virtually everyone in the United States knows of his heroism, knows of his deeds, but very few, if any, knew his name. Those of us who do know of his ideas remembered him only as the unknown hero, and that was in the terrible tragedy that took place down here on January 13, 1982. And the plane crashed into the bridge and into the ice-covered Potomac. And for a long, long time, we have known of the one man who repeatedly handed the line from the helicopter to others that he thought were in a worse situation than he was, saving five people in all. And then when the helicopter went back for him, he was no longer there. And now, an investigation by the Coast Guard and a thorough study has made it known that Arlen Williams, Jr. was the hero who gave his life that others might live. And we have here his family, Arlen and Virginia Williams, his son and daughter, Harold and Leslie, and Vice Commander of the Coast Guard, and we are awarding to him this medal. Some 607, I think it is, have been given in the 100 years history of the medal. There is a gold and a silver medal. Two gold were given to other heroes in this same tragedy, two silver, and now this one. And Time magazine said, if the man in the water gave a lifeline to the people gasping for survival, he was likewise giving a lifeline to those who observed him. And I think that is true, because all of us had to stand a little taller, witnessing this heroic deed and knowing now the man who gets the credit. Would you read the citation?
President, I'd be happy to. The Secretary of Transportation takes pleasure in presenting the Gold Life-Saving Medal posthumously to Arlen D. Williams, Jr. for acts set forth in the following citation. For extreme and heroic daring on the afternoon of 13 January 1982, following the crash of an airplane in the Potomac River in Washington, D.C., Mr. Williams was a passenger on an Air Florida 737 that crashed in a blinding snowstorm into the 14th Street Bridge that crosses the Potomac River and connects Washington, D.C. and Northern Virginia. After hitting the bridge, the plane plunged into the frozen waters of the Potomac River. Mr. Williams was seated in the rear section of the plane, which was partially above the water, when a U.S. Park Police helicopter arrived to commence rescue efforts. Mr. Williams, although injured, quickly realized that he was trapped in his seat by a jammed seatbelt. As the helicopter lowered a line to the survivors for towing them to shore, Mr. Williams, acknowledging the fact that he was trapped, refused to grab the line and passed it on to the other injured persons. The helicopter crew rescued five other survivors and then returned to Mr. Williams. He could not be found as he had sunk beneath the icy water. By not grabbing the rescue line and occupying valuable time in what would probably have been a futile attempt to pull himself free, other survivors who might have perished if they had been in the frigid waters much longer were saved. Mr. Williams sacrificed his own life so that others may live. Mr. Williams' unselfish actions and valiant service reflect the highest credit upon himself and were in keeping with the highest traditions of humanitarian service. Signed, Elizabeth Hanford Dole, Secretary of Transportation.
Mrs. Williams, I hope that you will receive this medal of your son. And to your son and daughter, let me just say, you can live with tremendous pride. That was before there was a U.S. Open.
Yeah.
Fort Mason at San Francisco is the port of embarkation.
Yeah, that's right.
And at that time, in the spring,
41, I believe.
After Pearl Harbor, in the spring, it was the only port.
That's where the dog trap was, the cow palace.
But I remember that one night in the cow palace,
yes,
there was a young lady singing with all of these troops up there in this big arena. And she was down on the stage, we put a show together, and she was singing. And her, was her husband had already been killed in the war. And all of a sudden, while she was singing, a man, a big sergeant, walked right up on the stage, whispered something to her. She stepped back, he stepped up to the microphone, and he read off the code numbers. Every unit had a code number. And with it, and the word that went with it told where they were going, and said to all of them, report in front of the building. And all over this arena, men began standing up, and you realize they had their packs, their weapons with them. They'd been warned that this might happen. Mm-hmm. And in the middle of that show, they started out. And I choke up thinking of it, because then all over, the other men were yelling goodbye to them and saying, we'll be there, we'll be with you. And this girl, with the tears streaming down her face, stepped back up to the microphone and started saying, God bless America.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It really was.
Mr. President, I'd like you to shake hands with Commander Addison. He is one of the people who worked tirelessly to bring this to attention of people here at the White House.
Kept us informed of what they were doing. Well,
thank you.
Establishing identity.
Thank you very much.
We've had about 150 telephone calls.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for
right. Margaret? Oops. Margaret? Well, that's the second feminine voice that wasn't Margaret. She's got quite a chain of command.
It's between her calls.
Margaret? Well, how am I? I am overjoyed and couldn't be happier, and you must be very pleased. What a landslide. Yes. Yes, yes, it will. And God bless you. It's just, it's a shot in the arm for all of us who have a kind of a solid philosophy worldwide to see this victory. Yes. If in the future I should have some need, how would you like to manage a campaign? Yes, but I'll tell you, I was on the plane coming back to Washington. I'd been out in the Middle West here when we got the news on the plane, but by then I knew that you must be enjoying a well-earned rest, so I waited until morning on our side to call you. Oh, listen, I couldn't wait. I've been waiting for quite a number of days here to make this call, and just was sure every day as I followed the reports from over there that I was going to be able to make it. And it just, believe me, I think there must be as much of a celebration mood here in our country today as there is in England. Well, thank you. Yes, and I had my ire up a little bit at one stage too, I recall, but well, everyone's been treating it here that way. Our press is a little reluctant about it, but they have to admit it. Yep. Well, I know you've got many things to do, but just know that we're all very happy here, and we congratulate you. Well, thank you. All right. Goodbye. Have a happy day. Bye.